Hello, Africa, and welcome to Impact Stories on AAU TV. AAU TV, the voice of higher education in Africa. Today, we are celebrating one academic mentor who has made his impact on the continent of Africa and beyond. My guest for today is Emeritus Professor of Chemistry and former Vice Chancellor of the University of Ghana, who was educated at the University of Ghana, Legon, and Churchill College, Cambridge University in the United Kingdom. He has worked in universities in Ghana, Chemistry Department in Legon, in Nigeria Drug Research Unit, Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Ife, Kenya Faculty of Pharma, and also he has worked in Germany for University of Pharmacy and Food Chemistry, University of Erlangen, where he was a fellow of the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation, a chartered chemist, and a fellow life of the Royal Society of Chemistry, fellow Ghana Academic of Art and Sciences. We'll go for a short break, and when we come back, we will get to know my guest. My name is Irene Dufiade, and this program is sponsored by the Association of African Universities.
This is Africa's most friendly nation, Ghana. A warm reception awaits you in an environment where you can discover and harness your full potential. Your home is an academic haven lying northeast of the city center, a quick dash from the airport. A spirited community where young, vibrant minds are empowered to express themselves, break academic boundaries, and thrive in an atmosphere of rich cultural heritage and excellence in various collegiate and extracurricular activities. This institution represents a whole new world of fun and offers you a variety of activities, facilities, and services geared towards your total development. Believing in the uniqueness of all our students, we encourage them to pursue excellence in integrity. Welcome to the University of Ghana, your preferred academic destination.
Welcome back to Impact Stories on AAU TV, and today we are excited to have here with us Professor Ivan Adaimensa, who has made his mark in chemistry, who has made his mark in academia on Africa and also beyond the continent. So, Prof, we are privileged to have you here, and thank you for welcoming us into your house.
Thank you very much. Yeah. You're also welcome to my house.
You're right. Prof, how have you been faring? It has been COVID this year, 2020. How are you doing, generally?
Well, I'm surviving.
Yes.
So far, so good. Mm. No problems as yet.
Yeah. And you are keeping fit?
I'm keeping fit.
That's good to know.
I exercise every day.
Every day?
Yes.
Yeah. Taking walks?
Inside this compound.
Oh, that's great.
10 rounds around here takes about 30 minutes of brisk walking.
Right.
So that's good enough for a day.
For you.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, Paul, we really want to know about you. My audience are excited about you. And then they want to know. So we want to go way back, maybe.
Way back from my childhood.
Yes, from your childhood. Aye. So we want to know who your parents were. We want to know your siblings. We want to know a little bit about your primary education.
Okay.
And where you started from.
Yeah. Well, I was born on 10th January 1942.
Right.
At Akimoda. Mm. In the eastern region. My father was then the headmaster of the Methodist school at Akim Swedru. Mm. And my mother was a domestic science teacher, what you now call home science. Or home economics.
Yeah.
She was teaching domestic science in the same school. That's how I came to be born at Akim Oda Hospital, because there was no hospital at Akim Swedru.
Right.
But being the last child of my parents, you know, I had two other brothers ahead of me. We were being transferred from one place to another very often. So by the time I was 3 years old, we were at Shama,
Right.
Oh, and that's okay. Where I started my kindergarten. Mm. 2 years later, we moved to Aburudunkwa. No, 1 year later, actually,
yeah.
After I was born. We moved to Aburudunkwa. And that's where I started class one at the age of five.
Right.
And from Aburudunkwa, we were transferred to Ejumakumbi Sianse. I spent my class two and class three in Ejumakumbi Sianse. Mm. So far, things were going all right. You know, parents were teachers, nothing tragic.
Mm-hmm.
Until when we were at Ejumakumbi Sianse, that's when problems started.
Mm.
I was only 7 years old
right.
when I lost my mother.
Right.
Apparently through complications in childbirth.
Okay.
And so after her burial, I don't know whether my father couldn't take it,
mm-hmm.
but almost immediately, within a week or two, he also fell ill.
Okay.
So we moved to our hometown, Adzim.
Mm.
Ostensibly for my father to have some medical attention at the
right.
Azim Hospital.
Mm.
So for 5 months, my brothers and I did not have any schooling.
Mm.
That was when my maternal grandmother, who was then at Takwa,
yeah.
got very worried and came down to Azim, decided to come and take us to Takwa.
Right.
My paternal grandmother decided that, well, she could take us to Takwa,
mm.
but then my eldest brother will have to stay on in Azim
yeah.
to take care of my father.
Right.
So having been out of school for 5 months, we moved to Takwa from May. My mother died in May, May 1949.
Right.
And November 1949, my grandmother tried to put us in school.
Yeah.
There was no place in school.
Mm.
But the headmaster of the then infant school, who had been a teacher under my father at Shama, agreed that I could go into class three, not have my name in the register, hang around.
Right.
So they gave me a stool, which I used as my desk for writing.
Wow.
But I sat on the floor. And the idea was that I will attend school for the 1 month that was left,
mm-hmm.
take the examination with the student, with the pupils at the end of the year. And if I passed, then I could officially be enrolled in the school.
Wow.
Well, the end of the year examinations came.
Mm.
5 years out of school, but I managed to come fourth.
In the class?
In the class, yes. So, well, my name was officially entered into the registrar,
yeah.
and I was promoted to standard one.
Mm.
So I was at Taco Methodist School. The brother after whom I directly come,
yeah.
he couldn't get a place in Methodist school, so he was sent to Anglican school,
mm.
where he spent about 2 years before he was moved to the Methodist school.
Right.
Well, we were there. My elder brother was still in Azim. And from Takwa Methodist School, I managed to pass the common entrance.
Right.
And came to Achimota School.
Right. Before you even get to Achimota yeah. School, what was a fond memory of your childhood?
Oh, my childhood.
Yes.
You know, my grandmother was old.
Mm.
She was over 60.
Mm.
It wasn't easy
right.
for her.
Right.
But we had to do a lot of petty trading.
Mm.
We used to sell bread. My brother and I were selling bread. We sold cloth. We sold sponge.
Mm.
We sold all sorts of things.
Right.
Just to be able to make ends meet.
Yeah.
There was a man who was living in the same compound house with us, who had a shop.
Right.
And what he did was to allow me to take some of the provisions he sold in the shop at wholesale price.
Right.
And then I'll go and sell. And then the profit, he had a notebook in which he entered everything that I sold.
Mm.
And the profit from it is what my grandmother used for paying our fees.
Right.
So that's how we managed to get through elementary school.
Right.
But there was a lot of social support.
Mm.
You know, the people around there who knew my parents gave us a lot of social support. And the children around, you know, we used to live at what one may call the lower middle class quarters of Takwa.
Right.
There were the bungalows where we used to go and steal mangoes and be chased by dogs and all that.
Right.
But then there was this area called New Layout, where many of the teachers, the nurses, the middle-level civil servants, the merchants, etc., also stayed.
Mm.
And many of them, you know, were friends to my parents when we were young.
Mm.
So they took great interest in us and gave us all the social support that we needed.
Yeah. So and to Achimota School?
Yeah. So I passed the common entrance.
Yeah.
Before then, my elder brother had, my father then died 2 years later.
Okay.
And so my elder brother moved to Sekendi.
Mm.
And at Sekendi, he managed to get to Mfanswim.
Wow.
And then the one after whom I come also went to Fijai. And then I followed last, what I usually call the last boy child, to Achimota School.
Right. So Achimota School, that is where the interest of science developed, or what took you to science in Achimota School?
Actually, in Achimota School, really, I could say that I was an all-rounder.
Mm.
And most of my classmates were all-rounders.
Mm.
I can mention some of my classmates in Achimota.
Mm.
Professor Justice Dateba,
right.
Supreme Court Judge, was my classmate. Emeritus Professor Albert Fiajo, who recently reviewed our constitution,
right.
was my classmate. Mr. James Kwashi Aidan, the former electoral commissioner, lawyer, was my classmate. Dr. Utute, a whole lot of Professor A.N. Mensah, Professor Nijan Dodu, so many of them. And our class was really formidable.
I know, looking at the
it
names.
It was really formidable.
It was.
Competition was keen.
Mm.
We set so many records.
Right.
That took a long time for others to come and break.
Yeah.
Both at O level and A level.
Mm.
So,
I just wanted to know what developed your interest going straight to University of Ghana to read
chemistry. Okay. Well, as I said, I think I could have done either arts or science, as my later exploits, or if I may say so, took me. But I opted for the sciences because I felt I wanted to go into the sciences.
Mm.
And I did well in the O level, I did well in the A level, and got admission into the University of Ghana.
Mm.
The late Professor Marianne Uramadi was my mate at Legon.
Mm.
We were both in the chemistry class. And we went through, we were selected for what was called a special honors degree.
Right.
And it was very keen, you know. If you got selected for special honors in a science subject, it meant that
you were brilliant.
It wasn't easy. For example, that year, only she and I were selected.
Right.
But then we got four more people joining us directly from A levels.
Mm.
So we were only six in the special honors class.
Mm.
So we went through Legon. At Legon, it wasn't all book.
Mm.
I was a keen sportsman from Achimota School,
both
in performance and also in commentary.
Yeah.
So we went through, I was in the university hockey team, I was in the university cricket team,
right.
And I was part of the team that went to Ibadan for the first West African Inter-Universities Games.
Right.
So it wasn't just my academic career that I pursued. Mm. After my BSc, I won an Elder Dempster scholarship to pursue my MSc. Mm. Incidentally, in Achimota School, I had both a government scholarship and a Cadbury and Fry scholarship.
Right.
Otherwise, I don't see how my grandmother could have
taken care
of us.
Yeah.
You know, it would have been impossible.
Yeah.
In fact, the Elder Dempster scholarship was backdated when I was in Form 3.
Right.
So it gave me the chance also to pay for private tuition to learn how to play the piano.
Right.
And Philippe Beho, our composer
our
of our national anthem, was my piano teacher.
Your tutor.
Yeah.
Right.
So I managed also to learn how to play the piano.
Mm-hmm.
Later on in life, I also learned how to play the flute.
Yeah.
So apart from science, I also had other
interests.
You were
doing other things. Yeah. And so right from the MSc, you moved straight away to London.
Yes, I got the University of Ghana scholarship to Churchill College, University of Cambridge.
Right. So why didn't you do the PhD here in Ghana, but rather decided?
At that time, facilities were just not available.
Mm.
It was impossible.
Right.
So everybody who did well enough was sent overseas.
Mm.
So in fact, I got admission to chemistry in Cambridge even before I finished my master's.
Right.
Yes, together with Professor Sumening, he went to Sussex.
Mm.
But we both were doing our master's when we got admission to the various universities.
To offer a PhD.
To offer the PhD in chemistry.
That is excellent.
Well, I don't know.
We need to acknowledge that indeed you were a brilliant student and it wasn't just a mean achievement.
Yeah.
You really pulled your socks off.
Yeah. So in Cambridge, Churchill College, my general supervisor was then the head of department, Professor Lord Todd, a Nobel laureate.
Yeah.
But my direct supervisor was Professor Cameron, an Australian.
Mm.
And they did a brilliant job on me.
Mm.
I wouldn't say that I did a brilliant job.
They refined you.
Yeah, they did a brilliant job on me.
Yeah.
And I managed to do my PhD.
Thesis.
Mm. Ahead of the stipulated 3 years.
PhD?
Yes. You did it in 2.5 years. So I submitted my thesis within 2.5 years. But the law in Cambridge at that time was that you had to spend 9 terms.
So you had to finish
before. So I had to hang around in the university until
I completed
the 9 terms. Mm. And I had made up my mind that I wouldn't stay in England a day longer than necessary.
That would have been my next question. I'm asking, why did you want to return?
I just wanted to come back to Ghana.
Mm.
Yeah. I don't know, but I loved Ghana.
Yeah, and it felt.
And of course, I had then met my wife also.
Okay.
We'll talk about her later.
We would.
Yeah.
we would.
So, I left Ghana in 1967, 21st September, the day of Kwame Nkrumah's birthday. That was Kwame Nkrumah's birthday.
Yeah.
And I came back to Ghana 20th September 1970.
Okay.
So exactly three years
after you had
no more, no less.
Right. And so how was it for you, the change in environment from Ghana to the UK? How was studies like? How did it impact your life?
Yeah, when I got to Cambridge, again, of course, there was a cultural change.
Mm.
That was my second time of flying in an aeroplane.
Mm.
The first time was when we went to Nigeria for the Inter-University Games.
Right.
There was a story to it.
Mm.
You know, we were going to Nigeria by bus. But when we got to the Togolese border, because there was some trouble between the president of Togo and Kwame Nkrumah, The Togolese wouldn't let us through.
Right.
So we came back.
Oh.
And Nkrumah, you know how he was.
Yeah.
He said, how dare these Togolese? Look, the VC-10,
mm-hmm.
Ghana Airways VC-10,
right,
which was going to London that evening.
Okay.
Don't go to London. Take the University of Ghana students to Nigeria,
wow.
30 minutes. Take them there, come back and take your London. So that was the first time I flew in an aeroplane.
Right.
And the second time was when I was going to Cambridge.
Yeah, great. And so this is Impact Stories on AAU TV, yeah. And I'm here with distinguished academic Professor Emeritus Ivan Ademensah. We'll go for a short break, and when we come back, we'll continue with our conversation. Do stay tuned.
Are you an institution or individual? Do you intend to organize a memorable event to be archived for future reference? Then look no further than AAU Studios, because it's your best bet. With our spacious studio and state-of-the-art media equipment such as 4K Panasonic video cameras, KinoFlow lights, assorted microphones, live streaming equipment, among others, you are sure to get the best of productions. Visit us at Trinity Avenue, East Legon, adjacent the National Accreditation Board, or contact the AAU Studios via the following email addresses: info@aau.org, aautv@aau.org, or ransford@aau.org. Alternatively, you can call us on +233 244 736280.
Welcome back. This is Impact Stories on AAU TV. We are still here with Professor Ivan Ademensah. And before we went on the break, Prof, you were talking about your second trip to the UK, and then you coming back right after.
Yeah.
So when you came back, your first work was you going back to the University of Ghana Chemistry Department.
Yeah.
How did it feel like?
Yeah, before I answer that question, let me mention that, well, when I got to Cambridge also, it wasn't just on my PhD that I concentrated.
Right.
I took part in a lot of things.
Mm.
There were a lot of Ghanaians there. There were a lot of Africans there.
Right.
So settling in was not difficult.
Okay.
There were Nigerians, there were Ghanaians. In fact, my roommate in Achimota, Dr. Joe Moedu, one of the foremost kidney specialists in the world.
Right.
Was there already doing medicine.
Mm.
In fact, I stayed with his father on my way to Cambridge.
Right.
So it wasn't difficult for me to fit in.
Mm.
In my second year, I was unanimously elected as the president of the African Students Union in Cambridge.
Right.
And I did a whole lot of things to raise a lot of money. For the
union
society.
Yeah.
To the extent that when I was in my third year, they decided that another Ghanaian should be the president.
Yes, because they felt the impact that you had.
Osetutu Prempeh, lawyer Osetutu Prempeh, became the next president.
Right.
Then I left and came to Ghana and joined the chemistry department.
Right.
Then Professor Toto was the head of department.
Mm.
Professor Korte was also there. And Professor Ajay Bekwin, who also became vice chancellor of the university, was also in the department. They had all taught me.
Right.
So I fitted in all right, and I got to work.
Yeah.
I moved through the ranks. I became a senior lecturer. I went on sabbatical on an OAU Scientific and Technical Committee fellowship to University of Ife in Nigeria for a year at the Faculty of Pharmacy in 1977.
Right.
I was promoted senior lecturer then. I came back, and in 1979, there was a little bit of a diversion in my life.
Okay.
Even though I remained in the university, I branched a little into politics.
Okay.
And there too, during the Third Republic, I joined the People's National PND, Party.
Okay.
And I, sooner or later, I was made the Secretary General of that party.
Right.
We won the election. I remained Secretary General until one of my juniors in school decided to take over the government. I mean, General.
Yeah.
And that led to my leaving the country.
Mm.
I passed through Abidjan, where I spent a year learning the French language.
Yeah.
I already had done French for my O-level.
Right.
So I had a good background, but I managed to pick up a lot of French.
Yeah.
But instead of then going to France, a European country, I found myself in Germany on an Alexander von Humboldt Foundation Fellowship to the University of Erlangen in the School of Pharmacy and Food Chemistry, where I spent 2 years. And from there, I went to the University of Nairobi, Faculty of Pharmacy, where I was an associate professor for 5 years. And after 5 years, at that time, Professor Akil Akpasoya, who became your
the Secretary General,
was the Vice Chancellor of the University of Ghana, and he said, look, Ivan, it's about time
you come back home.
So I decided to leave the University of Nairobi and come back home as a full professor to the chemistry department.
Mm.
1 year later, I was made the head of chemistry department. Then Professor Benner became the vice chancellor. The following year, they voted for me as dean of the Faculty of Science. And even though I had been elected dean, Professor Benner wouldn't let me leave the headship of the chemistry department.
Right.
So I had to do a second year as head of department,
department
at the same
dean.
Time that I was dean.
Mm.
And after a year, I said, look, this job is very
tedious.
It's heavy being a head of department in the first place.
Yeah.
And it's heavier being a dean. I think I have energy, but it's a bit
difficult.
So someone else, my colleague Professor Asumening, was appointed the head, and I remained dean for another year.
Mm.
And the vice chancellorship position became vacant. I applied last minute, and we went through the process. We were 11 applicants.
Okay.
We were whittled down to four.
Mm.
And of the four, an interview was held, chaired by Nanaria Kwampim, who later became the chancellor of the university. And two names were then recommended to the council. I was one of the two.
Right.
You will be amazed to know who
the
second
other
person was.
I just can't wait.
Professor John Evans Atta-Mills.
Oh, amazing.
Who became the president
of
the country.
Yeah.
He was the other person.
Wow.
And I got the nod as the vice chancellor. So people sometimes tease me that, Ivan, you should have lost the vice chancellor.
Yeah, so that you become
would have
the
been
president.
The president of the country. But I liked my vice chancellor. In any case, Professor Mills was a year my junior in Atchmoter School.
Okay.
Later on, even we found that we were relations.
Mm.
So both positions came to the same
place. Yeah, it's true. And so we want to know your journey of being a vice chancellor. How was it? Did you enjoy you being a vice chancellor? Was it a position that you felt this was well done by me?
Yes, I think I will always remain very proud of my period of 6 years as vice chancellor.
Agreed.
I will always remain proud of it. Because when I got to the seat, we had a lot of problems in the university. Finances were extremely low. Facilities were very, very poor. Professor Benner and Professor Sawyer had done a lot But then we didn't have any source of any other income except government subvention. And it was going down every year.
Yeah.
So we decided that we needed to find other ways of financing the university. Mm. So at the level of the Committee of Vice Chancellors, we felt that people who had had the privilege of gaining admission to the university would have to make a modest contribution.
Right.
That's when the cost-sharing idea came.
Mm.
I had then become the president of the Vice Chancellors, Committee of Vice Chancellors. So I had to push through that process. And you can imagine how difficult
it would
was
be because
with student protests and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So I wrote a memo to the Council of State,
right,
telling them the problems that we were facing. And Council of State invited me for a discussion. Mm-hmm. I went there, I laid bare the problems, and to cut a long story short, government accepted the idea.
Right.
And President Rawlings said that, I told the Minister of Education, who was then Spiegelberg, my junior by so many years in Archimota School, and Ibn Chambers,
right,
the big man himself,
who
was my tutorial student in Sabah Hall.
Wow.
I was his tutor in Sabah Hall. He was then the deputy minister in charge of tertiary education to give me all the support to push through this policy. And eventually we pushed it through. If the universities have now survived, everybody admits it.
Right.
It is as a result of this cost sharing.
Yeah.
When we started, the cost sharing was providing just about 5% of the total requirements. So, you know, we didn't want to burden. And then we wanted the idea of contributing to be accepted in the first place.
Sure.
It was a bold, innovative,
decision
and paradigm-shifting decision.
Mm.
But gradually, you know, government after government has seen the wisdom in it.
Yeah.
And I think parents, in fact, we had a lot of support from parents. A lot of them felt they were needy people.
Yeah.
I would agree that there were a lot of needy people
Yeah.
who needed support. And we established the Needy Students Program in support of the cost sharing, so that those who were contributing from their parents, whatever they contributed, some of it could be used to assist the really needy students. It was very easy to do that.
Yeah.
And that's how the universities have survived up to date.
Yeah.
Now, virtually everything else that the universities depend on come from the cost sharing system.
Yeah. So one significant thing about you when I entered the University of Ghana is the runabout that has been named after you. And so it's big, Professor Ivan Adaimensah. And so I wanted to ask, this is a memorabilia for me, but for you, which of your publications do you think that when you take it, we will say that this is Professor Ivan Adaimensah? Because I can't go through all. It's amazing. There are about hundreds of them.
Yes.
But which one do you think that this is you, this represent what your God-given talent and how brilliant you are?
Well, you know, I've written a lot of books, about 17 of them.
Yes.
The last book I wrote was the 650-page biography of former President Hilary Mann, which even the political scientists admit
that
it is the most authoritative account of the Third Republic ever written by anybody.
Mm.
But that's not my area.
Exactly.
You know. In chemistry, I've written books for the secondary schools.
Mm.
And I think those books have impacted a great deal on students.
Mm.
I was in America recently for a conference.
Mm.
conference of the Association of Black Chemists and Chemical Engineers in the U.S. Mm-hmm. And there were some Ghanaian top class scientists.
Right.
One of whom had even been tipped to be a Nobel laureate one day.
Right.
Professor Soga of Cornell University.
Yeah.
And they all said that I taught them either in secondary school or in university. And they were all mentioning some of the books that I had written for secondary schools. And everybody was hearing about this book that I had written. So when I was going to be introduced to give my keynote address, the president of the association said that there is a book that everybody is talking about.
Right.
What is this book at all that, you know, virtually everyone who is somebody in chemistry in Ghana has read? You know, that's what he said.
Yeah.
And that's when I realized that even below the university level, at the secondary school level, I must have impacted a lot of children.
Yeah.
And then when I was in Nairobi, I also wrote a book specifically for the Nairobi ONA level examinations. So I must have impacted a lot of students in Nairobi as well. You know. So these are some of the things that I'm proud of. Yeah. When it comes to my research, the publications are numerous.
A lot.
But what I can say is that the impact that my publications and outreach programs have made on herbal practice, not only in Ghana, but in Africa, is immense.
Yeah.
One of the books is this Floristic Studies in Ghana, which I co-authored with several other people, and it was financed and sponsored by the African Union, Scientific and Technical Research African Union.
Yeah.
They supported the writing of that book. Virtually every herbalist who is practicing in this country makes use of that.
Yes. Yeah. So we want to talk about an honor or an award that you think, even if I am not acknowledged anywhere anymore, this is okay for me. Which particular one will you choose?
If you want me to choose, okay, that those that really specify my impact on society and education, I will single out the three honorary degrees that I've received from one from the University of Ghana, Doctor of Science, Honoris Causa, the other Doctor of Humane Letters from New York University, and the third is the highest honor of Soka University, Japan. So that is in the academic area. When it comes to impact on society, then I'll single out the Companion of the Order of the Volta, which I got in 2006 when the President Kufuor was in power.
So before
there is one honor which may look insignificant, but which to me tells a lot. Two traditional chiefs who are not from my hometown area, Denzima area, one from Bremane Sikuma and the other from Koforidua, New Jabin, have both honored me for my contribution to education. I think it tells a lot. There are several other honors, but these are the ones that I think stand out.
So we would want to quickly run into your family, your nuclear family. But before we go to that, I just want to ask that, would there be a time you would say that, okay, I'm not writing anymore, I have put my pen down?
That one, I always cite the former headmaster of Mfanspum, Mr. Battels, who said that the day you stop working is the day you die.
Right.
And you know, he died 3 days after publishing his last book at the age of 101.
Okay.
Yeah. So at the moment, I'm working on my autobiography.
Right.
I'm working on my autobiography. But I'm also working on, my father wrote a book in 1933. And the book was called National Problems.
Right.
Fortunately, I have a book, I have a copy. And when I read that book and I see the sort of national problems he wrote about and what national problems we are going through now,
yeah,
it's still the same.
Right.
So I am trying to join the two together, national problems, thoughts of a father and a son.
Right.
So these are the two books that I'm working on now. Yeah. I hope that God will give me enough strength.
He will.
Between
he will.
Now and the day he himself will call me to finish these two.
Yeah.
But, I still mentor a lot of students.
Right.
And that keeps me working on academic things.
That would have been my next thing. Yeah. You have mentioned a lot of prolific names.
Yeah.
Which when we mention your name, we know that they came out from you. So who are some of these people that you have been mentoring? I know that you are going to give me names, but I still want to know and how proud you are of them.
It's difficult to really, maybe I can mention
a few.
The first chemistry professor in the University of Ghana, Dr. Dorcas Osei Safo.
Right.
I supervised her for her PhD. And she's doing very, very well.
Yeah.
When you, I just can't, I don't want to mention people and leave others out because they are numerous.
Yeah.
But in Nairobi also, Professor Anastasia Gwantai, who became dean of the Faculty of Pharmacy.
Mm.
I supervised her PhD. She is the one who worked on the Artemisia plant, which is now being touted as a treatment for COVID.
Yeah, okay.
Yes. Okay. Then Madagascar
one.
Mm. Yeah. She worked on it under my supervision in the late 80s. For her PhD. And we got a whole lot of things. So I am not new to that plant, She is another one I can say I mentored. And another one who also became a dean of the same faculty, Professor Grace Toity in Nairobi. So my influence on people goes beyond Ghana.
Of course.
Yeah.
To the world at large.
Yeah, I suppose so.
So we just want to know how you met your wife.
Yeah.
I think there should be a bit of story to that.
Well, before we move to my family, I must mention that when I retired as vice chancellor, because I can't go through this interview without mentioning this.
Yeah.
I worked for 6 months as director of research at the Association of African Universities. And before then, I had appeared on the AAU's platform on about three or four occasions on Africa Universities Day as either a keynote speaker or as a respondent to the debates. So at the level of AAU, I have made some contributions.
You have. You really have all
so
over
you have
Africa.
To note that.
So we want to talk about your wife.
Yes. It was when I was in Britain, during my second year, during my PhD.
Right.
She had already finished University of Leicester, and had finished her master's at Swansea, University of Swansea, and was working as a children's officer at the Borough of Ealing Council.
Right.
Incidentally, she happens to be the daughter of one of Ghana's biggest industrialists, the late Dr. PK Enimado.
Right.
Yes, from Abitifi.
Yeah.
The first person to actually start a bank in this country.
Mm.
It is his bank, which later became the Ghana Commercial Bank. And he was one of the first directors of Ghana Commercial Bank.
Right.
But he turned his bank into the first Ghana Building Society, which was giving loans to. So that's the daughter.
Mm.
And the elder sister is Mrs. Georgina Kinsley-Ina,
okay.
The mother of Alan Chiramantin's wife.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So that's her background.
Right.
So we met at a function of the African Society in London.
Mm.
I had come down from Cambridge with Professor Folsen and Professor de Graaf Hansen to that program. And she was there attending the same program. That's how we met.
Mm.
And I had known her brothers in school. Her brothers were my senior in school. So I already knew something about the family.
Mm.
But one thing led to another.
Right.
And she was also dying to come back to Ghana. So she decided to give up her lucrative job at the Borough of Ealing and come to Ghana.
Mm.
She worked with Ghana Textile Manufacturing Company.
Right.
I think she's still a director of the company.
Mm.
Though she has retired,
mm-hmm.
she's still also a director of Ghana Union Assurance.
Mm.
So that's her story.
Right.
Yeah.
So how did you meet? Is it at the function that
met? Yes, at the conference.
Okay.
We
so
met.
You have four kids?
Yes, we have four kids.
Yes.
Kojo, everybody knows Kojo. Kojo is the chief executive officer of Data Bank.
Oh, yes. I saw that.
And also a sports commentator.
Yeah.
That one, I don't know whether...
He got it from you.
He does a lot of sports commenting. Mm. And he is followed by Kweku, who is in the U.S.
Mm.
He did electronic engineering at KNUST.
Right.
But now he's a biomedical engineer. Mm. He did his doctorate in biomedical engineering at Vanderbilt University.
Mm.
So he's working with an engineering research and production company in the U.S.
Mm.
Then there is Nana, who was working with Vodafone Ghana and was transferred to Vodafone UK.
Right.
But now he's with another company in the Netherlands at Eindhoven. And then Efiba.
Yeah.
Efiba is a civil engineer.
Right.
She did civil engineering both up to the master's level.
Oh, that's science.
Yes, at KNUST.
Mm-hmm.
No, two science, two economists.
Yeah.
Nana and Kojo are economists.
Yeah.
Kweku and Efiba are engineers. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
When it comes to my brothers, my eldest brother, civil engineer, he worked with both Forestry Research Institute and KNUST and the Department of Civil Engineering. Unfortunately, she passed on last year.
Mm.
If you get to the gate, you'll see the poster is still there.
Yeah.
Yeah. But the one after him also retired as a professor of surgery at KNUST Medical School.
Right.
He's in the U.S. with a wife.
Yeah.
So now I'm the last.
Yeah.
You may see from outside that I'm looking.
You are looking
inside.
Young.
You don't know what's going on.
No, you are good. You are okay.
You
it's the inside that comes out. And so you are looking good. So, want to know on your social level, which music do you listen to? Who are those you listen to? I know you play the piano, so you'll be drifting to classicals and all of that. But aside that, you listen to our Ghanaian music.
Yes, yes. As my former music teacher used to say, I love from Bach, jazz Bach to boogie woogie.
Right.
B to B.
A to Z.
Every type of music, right. I can appreciate it. And I'm also a music critic. I have been in all sorts of things.
Well,
I always tell people that my first paid job was at the Ghana Broadcasting Corporation music department.
So you are an all-rounder.
My direct boss was Mike Egan.
An all-rounder.
Famous Mike Egan.
You are doing everything.
Yeah. And I also served as host, as you are doing now, for some GBC programs.
Right.
Periscope. I was host for Periscope for some time. And then, of course, I did football and other sports commentaries, also for GBC.
So when I want to come here, for you to open the door and the dogs not chase me out, which food should I bring you?
Which food?
Food, yes, your favorite food.
You know, let me tell you something. When I wrote Kofi Annan's biography, Kofi Annan had been a year behind my brother at Infants Film.
Okay.
And he told me how Kofi Annan loved tatari and beans.
Right.
Me, if you want to get me, you'll get me with fried plantain and beans.
Oh, that is that.
Yes.
So we can come here with fried plantain and the door will be open for us to go.
Unfortunately, as I said, because of some internal problems, I don't eat it as often as I used to.
Yeah.
Doctor's advice.
Doctor's advice at this age. We'll keep it down.
But I like fruits. A lot of fruits.
That's amazing. And so this very important question that we asked and then we bring the show to a close is that you've really worked from your humble background through to the highest position in a university. Even branched into politics, where we will come back again for that discussion. Written a lot of books, done a lot of publications, influenced lives, mentored a lot of big people, worked with a lot of people. We want to know if you think that what you've done and where you are now, you are an accomplished person.
That I will leave to others to judge. I don't like blowing my own horn.
Right.
Even though it was Isaac Newton who said that if you don't blow your horn, no one will blow it for you.
Yes.
But if you have found it necessary and expedient to come and interview me among those you have selected for the series, then it tells a lot. I'll leave it to the general public to decide. But from the recognition that I get when I go to certain places, I can probably say that I've not done too badly. And I'm still not doing too badly. Twice a year, I'm part of a team that runs a program for PhD students from all over Africa, teaching them African academic writing and communicating science, communication of science. They come from all over Africa, mainly even from Nigeria. But we've had people from Senegal, from Togo, from Nairobi, from Kenya. So I haven't finished impacting people. I'm still impacting people.
Right.
And for as long as I have strength, I love doing it. As emeritus professor, I do these things for free. That's what many people don't know. I'm not paid for what I do.
Right.
It's just that I love it. I could have just said, I've retired. Let me put my legs across my
and just be
home and watch television.
Yes.
But that will also send me to my grave early.
True. You know. That is very true. Yeah. And so, Prof, I don't know, I don't have enough words because I am sitting in front of greatness. You've done a lot for Ghana, you've done a lot for Africa. You have impacted lives, and I am glad to be the one to host this program. I'm glad to be the one to have the privilege of interviewing you, showing the world who you are, what you are made of, and the impact you've had on society. And we wish that more people will come to you and come and learn from you, come and listen to what you have for them, and it would help with their lives. I think I have taken a lot from you. I've taken a lot from how you started at a younger age, sitting out from school and then coming back to be fourth. It's not an easy achievement. And so thank you, Paul, for having us in your house.
Well, after that fourth position, I must say that I improved.
Yes, you did.
I monopolized
the first position.
I wouldn't say I monopolized it entirely. There were two others who gave me quite a tough time.
Yes.
One of them is Mrs. Dorcas. She used to be called Dorcas Baine, who went to Wesley Girls.
Yeah.
She became the chief director, acting chief director of Ministry of Agriculture. She really was tough. And then the other one was my closest friend in school, Dr. Samuel Amu, who later, he worked with the UN, but during Kufuor's time, he became the National Security Advisor. These were the three who were, he went to Addis Ababa. But Amu, for example, always tells a story, which, you know, he said, when we were going to do the common entrance, the father told him to select Achimota School. But without telling the father too was a schoolmaster. Without telling the father, he selected Addis Ababa. So when the letters for interview came, the father realized that he didn't select Achimota. So the father asked him, why did I tell you to choose Achimota and then you went and selected Addis Ababa? He said, I'm in class with Ivan.
He's always taking
a class
again.
Go to Achimota. I'm also going to a place where I can also be first.
I agree with him. So thank you, Paul, for this insightful conversation. We would come back for the political part.
Oh, I see.
Of you being the general secretary.
Okay. That's a whole new program.
Yes, it will be a whole new program. In case you just tuned in, this has been Impact Stories with Emeritus Professor Ivan Ademensah. You can catch our program on Association of African Universities on Facebook and on YouTube. My name is Irene Dufiade, and I've been privileged to be the host of this conversation. Do stay tuned.
Good morning to all participants. Good morning to the fellows, all our international collaborators, our chair of this session, and of course, all the WACBIF faculty and partners all over the world. So what I'm going to do here is just basically talk a little bit about COVID-19 in Ghana. And I will intersperse that with a few snapshots of some of the data and the research that we are doing in Ghana, and how the science, we are trying to use science to basically explain COVID-19 in Ghana. So, I will leave it this way. Yes. So very early on, before we even had the first cases in Ghana, we started thinking of planning ahead on a research protocol, which is was a very ambitious and broad research protocol to look at viral sequencing along with host genetic background, also to try to study the host immune responses, also developing a protocol to evaluate rapid antibody kits. This was actually something I had written down before I knew that FDA was trying to do that, and to develop diagnostics for rapid screening of frontline workers and general population, and of course developing pseudoviral assays to evaluate drug screening and neutralization assays. So this was the protocol which basically underpins a lot of what we are doing at WACFIT. So the work that will be that I'll talk about and the work that we've been doing here at WACFIT are basically divided into two broad spheres, which is where we track the virus or where we understand the virus. And we started very early on doing some serological studies. That's trying to look at the prevalence of antibodies to this virus, and also working on some antibody and antigen ELISA. We did some sequencing and molecular epidemiology to try to track the virus. So one, you're tracking the immune response to the virus, the other, you're tracking the virus itself. And what that morphed into, and what we are doing a bit more of, is trying to understand the virus. And so I'll present a few snapshots of some immunological data, and other members of the group will present more in depth later, and also some virological studies. So, I mean, just to give a brief background on COVID-19, we all know that it's a disease that's caused by the virus SARS-CoV-2, and it's related to the initial SARS virus, which was serious acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2. The first one was 1. And initially, the most common symptom in Ghana that resulted in a positive test was loss of smell. From some of the seroprevalence work that we did, we see that the most common symptom in Ghana was probably nothing, or some, and there's a number of other symptoms. Currently, looking at anecdotally from people that we've interacted with, it seems that headache is a very consistent symptom, along with loss of smell. So Ghana was already sort of prepared to be, initially for this pandemic, due to the lessons learned from the Ebola outbreak earlier on. So there was already some screening at the airport. And then early on, a team from Noguchi was sent to Dakar to learn how to detect the virus, which is by PCR. And the National Influenza Control Program started testing new arrivals. March 11th, we had the first positive test, which was announced March 12th. Then there was a lockdown. And during the lockdown, the government embarked on what was an enhanced testing program. And that lockdown ended in April, when it was confirmed that there was extensive community spread. And at that point, there was, by the time that the lockdown ended, you had only 35% of the people who were testing positive had history of travel, compared to previously, early on in the outbreak, almost everybody had a history of travel or knew somebody who had traveled. And so what we wanted to do was to track the virus, the variants in the virus. So we did two batches of sequencing. That was in conjunction with colleagues at Noguchi. And the first batch included some of the earliest samples that were collected in Ghana, including the first patients. And then the second batch was somewhere in June, which at that point we thought was late in the Ghanaian outbreak. And this was, we published that work. This was the first detailed molecular analysis of SARS-CoV-2, one of the first in Africa. And it's very telling that at that point, there were only five variants. There were a number of variants. There were only five spike variants that we detected, even though there were a number of major variants already circulating around the world. And that led us to believe that the entry of highly evolved variants in Ghana was prevented by the early border closure. And that work showed that there was low level of transmission in the country because we didn't see a high level of mutations. Mutations usually indicate a high level of transmission. And at that time, we didn't have any estimates of prevalence in the country. So we embarked on what ended up being a 7-month seroprevalence study. Initially, in August 2020, we did about 1,305 participants, mostly in Greater Accra region. And we followed this up in December and February. And what we saw in phase one, which was in August, was that there was quite a high level of seroprevalence in Greater Accra region. I'll just mention that Professor Mutapi talked a little bit on this. We used a similar kit that they used, and we haven't really discussed it, but we had seen that IgM tended to, especially from febrile patient, tended to have some cross-reactivity. So that was something that was is actually written in the pamphlet or the kit. So we were checking temperature to make sure that we weren't including individuals with fever and things like that. And we didn't see a lot of IgM. But that's something that I'm sure that if Prof. Mutapi is online, her group has already looked into that. It's probably something related to febrile patients and maybe potentially malaria. So what we initially saw from our first seroprevalence study was that in Accra, at least, there was a very highly stratified exposure risk to COVID-19, meaning that if you were sampled, if you were sampled in the market, or if you were sampled in a COVID-19 testing center, if you had, if you were like 41 to 60 age group, or if you worked in the informal sector, you had an elevated chance that you had antibodies to COVID-19, which means that you've been exposed to the virus. If you had tertiary education, high income, and or formal employment, then you had a lower risk of having antibodies to COVID-19. That's shown in this table here. So 9.4 for people sampled in the shopping malls, that represents the higher income bracket, compared to 26.9 people sampled in the markets, representing the lower socioeconomic income. Now, as the pandemic evolved, as the Ghanaian outbreak evolved, we wanted to see whether our seroprevalence results was matching with the clinical results. And what we saw, did I go too far? Yeah. What we saw is that What we saw is that during our phase two, I'll go back to that graph in a second. During our phase two, our wave two in Ghana, which was in December going through to February, we actually saw that in the higher socioeconomic brackets, seroprevalence increased from 13% in August to 25% in February. And so that was very reflective of this peak of infections that we were seeing. So it showed that at that point, the level of seroprevalence in the population was so high that that risk stratification was lost, where the higher income earners were no longer having the lowest level of antibodies. That was what we saw from that. And then I'm showing this here. This is from the Ghana Health Service website. And this is taken today. So it shows you the change in the cases as at July 15th. But this is a primer for the next step of the work, which was beyond the first sequencing that we did. We wanted to keep sequencing and track the variant evolution in Ghana over time. And this was very important, especially in January, December, as the cases started to skyrocket. So this is the number of sequences. We have a few more now, but this is the number of sequences that we've done so far. And you can see that we have a high number of variants of concern, alpha. There's also eta, which is quite well represented here. And initially, most of these variants of concern were coming in from the into the country through travelers. So this, some of these were first detected in travelers, and then later on they showed up in the local circulation, as you can see in this graph. Looking at this schematic, all through 2020, we didn't see much variance of concern. Well, of course, variance of concern was denoted later on, but we didn't see a lot of variants that were going around the world at that time. Mostly it was B1 and A. These are very early variants of COVID-19, which are not that implicated in serious disease or implicated in high-level transmissions. Now you can see that in December 2020, that's still the case. January 2021 is the first time that we're starting to see the alpha variant. And that maintains its level of dominance in all our sequencing samples all through till, I believe, June 2021. What we saw is that we also had another variant, which is a variant of interest, eta. And you can see, did I remove that picture? So eta variant was actually very prevalent in the northern part of Ghana, whereas alpha was prevalent in the southern part of Ghana. So what we saw was that there was quite a dynamic in the variants that were circulating in the country at the time. So basically, from initially just 12 transmissible local genotypes circulating in Ghana, we ended up seeing that the evolution, the virus was evolving, and that was linked to the opening of the borders or the opening of the airport around October. And so as new variants come in, that ends up showing up in the local population. And the dominant dominant variants that are always linked to the waves, as we saw in February, this was dominated by eta and alpha, are imported. They are not locally evolved variants. And here in July, what we're seeing a lot of is actually Delta. Of course, the sample size here is quite small for July, but we have data which actually shows that the proportion of Delta in our symptomatic cases are now even more than what you're seeing here. So we are in the beginning of a third wave, which is now appears to be dominated by Delta and also this other variant under monitoring, which is the B1.1.318. All right, so I already presented this. And we've gotten some funding from Rockefeller Foundation to continue this work. and we'll be updating in due course what the current SERP prevalence in July and beyond is. And we have some data already, but I didn't want to share it here because it's quite high. So what do we know? So far, masks are still the single most important COVID-19 prevention measure. History tells us that each wave will be more severe than the last. And given that the vaccines are 60 to 90% efficacious at preventing disease and transmission, and then in Ghana, less than 1 million people are fully vaccinated. So we need to understand what our seeming tolerance to COVID-19 is in Ghana. And we also needed to understand whether herbal medications really work. So we ended up going into a bit of molecular studies. And already there was some published literature showing that IL-6, IL-10, some of these cytokines were implicated in serious disease. And that's a few literature. So there's some work here, which Keseho will be presenting in more detail later. And what we actually see is that it looks like in Ghana we don't have this cytokine storm which has been reported elsewhere in the world. At least with our preliminary data, that's what it seems to show. And if you look at levels of IL-6, TNF-alpha, and IL-10, these are actually quite low compared to other studies around the world. So this is just looking at the same cytokines. If you look at the levels of IL-6 here, how is it much lower, even in symptomatic patients? And interestingly, we saw eotaxin was very elevated in asymptomatic patients. Eotaxin is a cytokine which seems to be elevated in the lung tissues of asthma patients. And we've seen that asthma patients are somehow refractory to severe COVID-19 disease. So you can visit, you can listen to Kesebo's talk later on, and she's going to go into more detail on that immunology work. And what we've also seen, we did some blood grouping analysis because there was some early data which showed that blood groups might have an impact on COVID-19 severity. And knowing that in Africa, there's a high proportion of blood group O. So Fatima will be presenting this as a poster, but just to give a snapshot to what we're seeing is that there seems to be some association of symptomatic cases with blood group A, and a very strong positive correlation of asymptomatic cases with blood group O. So you can again go see Fatima's poster. Then what we wanted to do was to study the virus. To be able to study the virus, you have to develop assays that will allow you to track that interaction. That way you can do neutralization assays, you can screen for inhibitors. And what we developed was an ACE2 overexpressing cell. So we took HEK293 T cells, we looked at their surface level of the expression of ACE2, which is a receptor for the virus. It was quite low. And then we generated constitutively expressing cells which constitutively express the receptor. And you can see that that's the case here. And when you compare the level of ability to infect these cells, it's you can infect these cells with a pseudovirus which expresses spike protein. And we use this to screen for potential inhibitors. And you can see in the case where an inhibitor is a strong inhibitor and where it's not. So these are some of just some snapshots of the data. Aaron will be talking a bit more on this assay and its application later on. And we also, along the line, evaluated a cheap SARS-CoV-2 antigen ELISA, which when we costed it, you could do a test at less than £1 per sample. And this was through a collaboration with some guys at Southampton University, and that's been submitted for publication in the Journal of Infection. So we're able to see that we had some good data when your CT values are below 30. So it's very, it has high utility for tracking and detecting transmissible infections. So what does the science tell us so far? The current best practices in Ghana, given our low vaccination coverage, is that social distancing and mask wearing are the best practices so far. We have a high level of asymptomatic spread with increasing seroprevalence. We have, and then what we also saw, because variants arrived in Ghana at least a month later than they arrived in other countries which did not have antigen testing, that antigen testing at the airport has been very instrumental in helping to delay the importation of variants. And what we see is that the symptomatic infection waves, one of which we're in right now, are linked to new importations because there are always variants which have already started causing a wave elsewhere in the country. And the second wave in Ghana was dominated by Alpha in the south and Eta in the north. But since April, the B11.318 has been the most fastest growing outbreak. If you listen to Colin's talk, who's after me, I think he'll talk a little bit about that. And we may be in the early stages of a third wave. This is looking at the cases, and that seems to be dominated by Delta, and again, the B11.318. So we also learned that we may have some protection from severe disease due to an attenuated cytokine response. Of course, the sample size so far is not that great, but it could also be a high percentage of blood group O individuals in Ghana. And take-home message is that we have shown an ability to create and evaluate tools for testing and discovery in Ghana. We have also created the ability to make our own reagents for cheap testing and make the SARS-CoV-2 antigen here in Ghana. And we've shown that some of the herbal products which are being marketed do indeed have in vitro activity, though a lot of them don't. So I'll just end here by thanking the entire team and the sponsors and you for listening.
My name is Collins Misita Moranga. There has been more than 800 deaths in Ghana and about 4 million deaths worldwide. And the reason is that since last year, after the outbreak of COVID-19, the virus has been changing rapidly, and you can see between last year to maybe December 2021, you had about viruses with about 30 mutations. And this has quickly changed to about viruses with more than 40 mutations within a span of 6 months. And this is a substitution rate of about 25 substitutions a year. And this has contributed to the surge of new variants with high levels of transmissibility, virulence, pathogenicity, and some have risk of immune escape, and sometimes some of them cause disease severity and death. And the UN Health Agency has come up with Greek alphabets, denoting some of these variants so that to reduce stigmatization of various nations. So just to mention that the variants of concern, these are variants that increase transmissibility and virulence of the virus. They include the alpha variant, the beta variant, the gamma variant, and the delta variant. And we have variants of interest which mostly can cause community transmission or multiple clusters of infections, but they are not really increasing in terms of virulence. And these include Eta, Iota, and Kappa. So what we set out to do here at WorkBib was to determine the circulating variants as well as identify some of the variants of concern. We also decided to identify new variants that are in circulation as well as those that are being imported into Ghana, and also to determine the genomic evolution of variants in different regions across the country. So to do this, we sampled local samples, and we sampled across the country from the northern Ghana, central, the Ashanti region, Greater Accra, Eastern, and Borno East. And we also took some 95 samples from travelers and checked the variants. So in total, we've been able to do about 953 sequences. And to achieve this, we did sequencing mostly by mini-ion, and then we did phylogenetic analysis. And what the data is showing us is that mostly we have about 43 different lineages of variants circulating within Ghana from the sequencing data. And this is a combination of both variants that are not of concern to variants of interest as well as variants of concern. And you can see that the leading or the highest percentage is taken by the alpha variant, which is a variant of concern. And then we have the B.3.1.1.3.1.8, which is a new variant that is emerging in Ghana with about 17%, and the Eta variant. So these are probably the most new variants that we've seen circulating in Ghana, and you're going to see how they emerged within Ghana. I have to reiterate that about 50% of our samples are now currently variants of concern. And you can see that if you sample only the 2020 samples, whereby we had about 167 samples, we didn't have a lot of variants of concern or variants of interest. At least the top proportions of variants that were circulating was the B.1.1.1, which was highest across all regions within Ghana. This is from the Ashanti to Western region. But in 2021, we've managed to sequence about 630 samples, whereby the Greater Accra region is the highest number of samples that we've sequenced with about 260 samples, and the Northern region with about 173 samples. And what you can see is a clear difference that in 2021, we've had new variants, that is the variants of concern, showing up. And you can notice that in the Ashanti region, we have about, whereby we have about 27 samples sequenced to date, about 80% of them are around the Delta variant. And you might ask, where did these variants of concern came from? So when we checked our 95 samples, where the travel history of the samples, we realized that they came from all over the world, from the United States to Asia, and in fact, actually, our neighboring countries here in Ghana. And you can see that most of the variants that were introduced by travelers were the variants of concern, that is the B.1, the alpha variant, the beta variant, as well as the eta variant. And the alpha variant takes the highest proportion in terms of those that came in January as well as March. And you can see that now, in terms of circulation, the alpha variant is the highest. To look at the local samples, we've seen that we've sampled across all the months, and most of our sampling came in January, whereby we did about 209 samples. This was mostly to be able to track the introduction of the alpha variant within the country. And in May, we have also been able to sequence, at least in 2021, we've managed to sequence more than 50 samples every month. And you can see that there is a transition in terms of variants. And to clearly be able to see this is that out of these 858 samples, you can see that within 2020, we had the B.1.1 variant, which was circulating the most. And then it quickly dropped around December. And you can guess why this happened. It's probably because people came in for December holidays and they introduced this alpha variant. And the B.117 alpha variant took over and started circulating, and it dominated between January to April, where it has quickly fallen off. And we have a different variant that has dominated since March. And it's been increasing till June. We haven't done so many samples in July. It's only about 9 samples, and maybe that's why we are seeing the shift. But the Delta variant looks like most of the samples that we sequenced in July has the highest proportion. And if we zoom into Greater Accra, which has the highest number of the B.1.1.318 variant, you can see that out of the 284 samples that are from Accra, the 318 is the highest between February to July. And the question is why? Why is this variant being highly transmissible within Ghana? And only a few samples are for the Delta variant within the Accra samples. But you realize that there's been shifts in terms of which variants are circulating. And right now, the alpha variant has gone down, especially in Accra, and the 318 variant is coming up. We are still asking questions about this variant and investigating it more. And I would like to summarize by saying that the local transmission was initially dominated by the B.11 lineage until the emergence of the SARS-CoV-2 variants of concern. And transmission in the northern region was dominated mainly by the variant of interest, ITA. And the Delta variant, which was first detected in May in Ghana, is now leading in July, as we've seen. And air travelers were mostly the major source of variants of concern entering the country. I mean, that's not to say that other ports were also involved in the introduction of these variants of concern. And there are many unique variants within Ghana. As I mentioned, we have about 43 different lineages circulating, and which can indicate that there's an ongoing transmissions and potentially locally seeded outbreaks, such as what we've seen with the B.318 variant. And what we intend to do now is to sequence more samples so that we can track new and emerging variants from different regions, and also to determine whether these variants are of concern or of interest. And also we can continue to liaise with the government in providing real-time information as a research center to influence policy. I would like to acknowledge the different institutions that we've been able to get the samples from, and this is all the way from Accra to Kintampo to Navrongo, all the samples that we've been able to sequence. We acknowledge those labs for providing the samples. We also would like to acknowledge the funders, and then thank you very much.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Collins, for a very good presentation. This is an example of what the senior members and the students do here at WAPEGO. We have time for a few questions.
Can you put your hand on any sample that you can call a Ghanaian spirit?
So from the first.
Can I ask one more question?
Okay.
And then you also said before the first report of COVID in Ghana, you had planned to do studies of virus and and then the RGGs and others.
Yeah.
I'm wondering, I know you are not a prophet, but I'm wondering whether you had an idea, a hint of the coming COVID, and that means you can inform you of that plan to study virus.
Okay. So I think most of the variants that we've seen have mutations that have been reported elsewhere. I think in the very first round of sequencing that we did, which was during the when the borders were closed, it looked like some of the mutations that we detected in those rounds had not been reported elsewhere. Currently, right now, it's very hard to say whether, because we, if as Colin said, if you look at the mutational background of some of the variants, some of the combinations seem unique, but we can't say for sure whether if it's locally grown. I think Colin can speak a little bit to that too, because they have the same. What we are seeing is it's an E 484 mutation. They have the same sort of cocktail of mutations. It's just that the background is slightly different. So it's hard to tell right now. What we will be, if we sequence more samples consistently, then we'll be able to know for sure whether really what we think are some of these variants which are homegrown. And in those cases, usually it's one or two, or it's not a lot. So that actually does give evidence that it might be homegrown, but they are not transmissible. So if they are not transmissible, then you don't really care about them that much. To your second question, actually, I was, towards the end of my PhD, I was looking at what I think are the new, what viruses might be new emerging. So I was actually looking at MERS. So I had some literature on MERS because it was very similar to SARS-1, and it was sort of expanding. So I already had some ideas on things that could be done. And so I, for one, wasn't that surprised when SARS-CoV-2 came up, because there was already hints that there would be a pandemic virus. And if you keep, there were a number of emerging viruses that had started, but nothing had really taken root. So, not that I'm a prophet, but I think it was one of the things that you realize that there's always going to be a few viruses of concern, and every once in a while, one of them will break through and cause some hardship. Do you want to answer a bit about that?
So maybe something to your first question. So we have a lot of variants with background mutations, and the classifications of these variants depends on the background mutations. So if they've been reported around the world with specific background mutations, then they'll be having those ones, they'll be classified as that particular variant. But then you realize that most of some of these samples, they have other mutations. But because the variants are not penetrated in terms of transmission or virulence, then it makes it people don't really pay so much attention to classifying these particular variants, even if they have extra mutations.
Yeah, I mean, I think because we're also just focusing on spike, you know, there's mutations in all the other parts of the virus too. But yeah.
Thank you. My question actually goes to Mr. Peter Quashie. And it's on your sampling. You have data that we know the sample strategy. I don't know if I got you right, but the population the sample for market, shopping malls, and
yes.
But also you mentioned people employed and unemployed, right?
Okay.
I wish that by sampling people from marketplaces and malls, for people who work in offices, schools, and that would give a fair comparison in regards to the place of work.
Okay, so
you're talking about employment here.
Yes.
So that you tie employment to something else that you think would be the reason for influencing the degree. Mm-hmm. I don't really see how employment, somebody being employed or not being employed, can affect
okay. Okay. Thanks.
Can we please hold on? We are running out of time, so okay. Can we take Elvis' question? Please, the question should be short, and there's also a hand here.
Okay.
On the virtue. So when we get the very question that is okay. Responding, should we please?
My question goes to colleagues. So what informed your decision to name VOC and VOI?
Okay, thanks for the first question. So basically, the institutional sampling is what's one of the strategies that we want to use now. When we started, we wanted to get a good sample size, a snapshot of the population. And we thought that sampling in marketplaces and sampling in malls, you're going to get a good snapshot of the general population because people go to the markets and people go to the malls, but it's not necessarily the same people who go to these places. And then alongside our testing, we also deploy a questionnaire which asks them about employment, about, there were many questions. So once you get that data, then we basically did regression analysis of the positivity linked to the answers of those questionnaires. And what we saw was actually quite striking when we saw it, that having, like I said, informal employment was very strongly correlated with having a high positivity rate. And when you actually think about it, especially people in the market tend to take trotro. You know, especially when we did this was in August when we first started, they take trotro. They don't have the ability to necessarily protect themselves. And alongside that time, Ghana Health Service had done a survey which was showing that about 40% of the population had a mask with the intent to wear it, right? And then when you go to the malls were the population that were actually sampled at the malls, if you look at their education, were mostly degree holders, had higher income, and they were, when you think about it, they are more likely to protect themselves because they have the ability to drive their car to the mall and not necessarily be exposed in the environment. So those were the things that we observed. It's not something that we expected to observe, but that's what the data told us. I don't know if that answers your question.
I think the conversation will continue.
Yeah.
You have a question to
answer. Yes.
Please, can you interpret?
So in terms of a variant of concern, is basically a variant that increases transmission or transmissibility of the virus, as well as virulence. Virulence in terms of more people falling severely sick, and if some even dying. And a variant of interest is a variant that is localized with, let's say, clusters of outbreaks, but does not increase transmission to even other populations, as well as does not cause severe illness. But there are more people having that particular variant, then we just call it variant of interest.
Oh, and it's designated by WHO.
Yeah, he's saying that they are actually designated by WHO. Yes.
Okay, so there's a question here before you go from someone online. Asking whether the Delta variant, the increase of the Delta variant is as a result of transmissibility of the variant.
or the combination of the Eastern Civilization Intervention Task Force?
I believe it's because of transmissibility. I didn't hear that.
They are all on the same to the here.
Okay. So the data so far shows from all around the world that it's a transmissibility issue. I didn't hear the second part of the question, actually. But
it's asking whether it's more like realization of our preventive.
Oh, okay. I mean, regardless of what variant it is, if you relax the protocols, transmissions will go up.
Thank you very much. I just want to say that he says we should wear our masks. That is a sure way of working against this COVID. Some of us are saying we have taken the vaccine. You have taken, your brother, your sister has not taken. So you may not be severely ill. But if you pass it on to someone who has not taken the vaccine, the person may die. So please, let's keep our masks on. Thank you for joining us for this session.
I would attempt to summarize what we've gone through the past 2.5 hours. But there are four key points that I've picked up this morning. And I must admit, I really enjoyed this morning's session. I've learned a lot. The first is we need to congratulate the center for going through the Delta 2 call. And this is something that already we are proud of. And I'm hoping that the miracle behind the WAPIC machine will be shared with a bigger university so that other units will see this light. The second is the importance of academia research policy linkage. And I think WAPIC has demonstrated that perfectly. The third is the need for collaboration, and here collaboration within the country, and then with the rest of the world, especially within Africa, so that we can fight this pandemic. The last that I want to stress is how WAPIC and in general, in the science community, encourage females to be part of this, or to encourage females into science. And I'm hoping that, I'm sure after this faith conference, WAPIC will start planning the Sith. And I'm hoping that we'll see science or effort being made by WAPIC, since they are leading in most of the things that we've discussed this morning, how we can bring females into science. I have daughters, and one is doing science, and I appreciate the challenge they go through. But I think the machine of WAPIC, I think it's been greased enough, and it's working, so I know it will also work. So on this note, I will wish you all a successful 3 days conference, and I hope you have a fruitful deliberation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Asante,
our provost for research. All right, so we've come to the end of the opening ceremony. Before we go, I want to acknowledge some other important personalities that came in. I think we have the Dean of School of Biological Sciences. He was sitting here, he just moved. Okay, Professor Augustine Oklu was here. We see our distinguished dean for the business school, University of Ghana Business School. Professor Baule is over there. Thank you. Here online we have some others who have joined online. Let me just check the latest updates, so that we acknowledge everybody who has made time to join us. We have Ms. Eccles Andor, who is our Acting Director of Public Affairs. She joined us online. Thank you very much. We have Professor Lamte from the University of Ghana Medical School, who joined us online. Thank you. Dr. Daniel Dijomel is here from WACI. The Deputy Director of WACI is here. Thank you very much. Our College Secretary, Mr. Emmanuel Bedu, is here. He's a strong supporter of WACI. Thank you very much. Have I left anybody? Mark Idana wasn't here when I introduced him, so he's now here. Professor Mark Idana is here. He's the Dean of Physical and Mathematical Sciences. I also see Professor Eric Tiburu, who is the Chair of our College Research Board. Professor Elvis Tiburu, who is also one of our WACBIP faculty. Great. So this is the end of the morning session. Oh, I see Head of Department of Biomedical Engineering there, Professor Moore. Thank you. Okay. Professor Guineo Helegbe is from UDS. Thank you, one of our collaborators. I see him here. All right. I think I've acknowledged all our invited guests. Okay. So we'll go and take some pictures with all protocols observed. Please keep your mask on. Your face will still be seen. So we'll take some pictures briefly outside. And then we will have a short ceremony where the Aruba Secretary General would inspect one of the equipment that they bought for us. They bought us a new sequencer. So they bought us a NextSeq 2000, which cost almost 400,000 through a grant that was facilitated by our ORID. So ORID Pro VC and Aruba Secretary General will show them the equipment that has been delivered through this project, and we are very grateful for the support. So thank you. Let's take some pictures and then we'll be back.
Well, we are joined here by the director of WACBIP, and he's in the person of Professor Gordon Awandari. Prof, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Okay. Well, Prof, today, listening to the event, I realized that this is the fifth time this research conference has been organized here at WACBIP. But I want to know the main motive behind this conference.
Well, thank you very much. So it is really simple. We started the conference in 2016. You know, the center started in 2014. And so after about a year or two, we realized that, you know, we were accumulating a lot of research data, and we wanted to find a platform where we can share this data widely and also give our trainees the opportunity to present in front of an international audience and get feedback and interactions with, some of the leading scientists in the world who collaborate with us. So basically, it's a platform for our fellows to present their work to the world and to policymakers. And number two is for us to engage with the public and policymakers and discuss what we are doing and get their input so that we can improve on what we are doing to make sure that the research we are doing is answering questions that need to be answered, and that we are focused on diseases that are of interest to the country and to Africa. So that's really what it is. It's a platform for informing the world about our research and also getting feedback.
Okay. Well, Prof, I want to find out the impact these conferences has had on people, researchers, people in the community in the past years.
Well, So I'll look at it in two ways. Our fellows, the research conference has given them a platform to showcase their work. And a lot of them have benefited so much from the feedback they get from, the global community that joined these conferences. So that's on their part. On the part of policymakers and the general public, then they get let in into what we do here. And they get a flavor of all the research that we do, the new findings that we have, like today you heard about the different variants and which variants are fueling the current search. So it's two-way. Our fellows get the stage to showcase their work and also gain experience from presenting on the international scene. And then our audience, which includes scientists, policymakers, media people, and the general public, they get to know what we're doing and hopefully tell us what else we should be doing.
Well, for my final question, I want to find out what impact you expect this conference to have on people by the end of this three-day conference.
So we hope that at the end of the conference, the general public will know more about the work that we do. Normally, they only hear a little bit here and there about what we're doing. But this is 3 days of presentations and a heavy schedule to basically put more meat on the bone and showcase the details of what we do and what all that means for our health and for our communities.
Well, we are also joined here by Dr. Peter Kwashi. Doc, thank you very much for making time.
You're welcome.
Okay, Doc, in your speech, you mentioned that there are some variants of concern. So I'll be very glad if you can highlight on a few of them.
Okay, so the World Health Organization has designated variants because there's a lot of variants. And to streamline and make it easier to understand, they've designated variants of concern, variants of interest, and variants under monitoring. So when something is called a variant of concern, that means that it has shown that it has a high level of transmissibility and it is causing outbreaks all around the world. And it possibly has high risk of fatality. When it's a variant of interest, that means there's evidence for all of that, but it's localized and it hasn't spread that much. And the same for variant under monitoring. So to be elevated, you have to have more evidence that this is more transmissible and more likely to cause serious disease. So currently in Ghana, we have two main variants which seem to be circulating. And we have the Delta variant, which is a variant of concern. And then we have what we said, B1.1.318, which is a variant under monitoring. That means it has caused some outbreaks elsewhere, but the evidence hasn't been strong enough for it to be either a variant of interest or a variant of concern.
Okay. Well, Doc, I'm very glad you mentioned the Delta variant. Can you please let us know the symptoms for this variant? Because certain research out there says the symptoms are different from the previous variants that we experienced.
So, as this pandemic has evolved, we've had a whole plethora of symptoms, right? And most of them are sort of related to cold symptoms. This Delta variant, when I look at it, I feel like it resembles more the SARS-1, which is, more cases of pneumonia. So anecdotally, what I'm hearing from the clinicians is it has a high chance of it appearing to have not much symptoms, maybe headache, loss of smell of taste, and then pneumonia, which is not what we've seen with a lot of the previous variants. So that seems to be a slight shift, but I don't know if it's a slight shift. It's not a huge shift because as the pandemic has evolved, the symptoms have always changed, and it depends on one person will get a headache, the other person will get running stomach and things like that.
Okay. Well, Doc, is there a reason behind why in Ghana here the rate of COVID death is low, and even in Africa, is there a reason behind that?
So, like I said, that's one of the things that we've started to work on. And our preliminary data shows that in Ghana, we might not be experiencing the cytokine storm that has been experienced in other parts of the world. So we look at the cytokines are proteins, immune system proteins within your blood. So we look at the levels of them, and we look at the levels in symptomatic patients and asymptomatic patients. And what we've seen that in Ghana, even with the symptomatic patients, the levels are much lower than what has been reported from elsewhere in the world. And then the key ones which have been implicated for severe disease are still low in Ghana. So that's one possible reason why we don't see high levels of severe disease. The other reason is, and this is again preliminary data, we have very few sample sizes, is that there seems to be an association of blood group with asymptomatic infection. So specifically, blood group O seems to be associated with asymptomatic infection. And this is something that we are still working on, and one of my students will be presenting it in a poster. So these are the two. There are many hypotheses as to why we are not seeing that severe disease, but these are the two that we have some data on, and that we are working on others, but these are the two that seem to be plausible right now.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
It's always a pleasure bringing you new and interesting episodes of Ladies Digest, where issues in the world of women are discussed. Ladies Digest is proudly brought to you by AAU TV, the voice of higher education in Africa. In our previous episodes, we discussed infertility in women, and we brushed over a particular technique, which is the assisted conception technique. And in today's episode, we're going to be treating it in detail. You sure don't want to miss this episode. I'm Joan Ekuya Iyoha. Remember, you can join us on our social media handles at Ladies Digest on Instagram and Facebook and YouTube at the Association of African Universities. After this time out, we get to meet our guest. Welcome back, and if you're just joining us, this is Ladies Digest, and we are reaching you live from AAU TV, the voice of higher education in Africa. Before the break, I introduced today's episode as assisted conception technique, and that was what we'll be treating today. And we have in our midst our regular guest, our regular resource person, Dr. Kwejo Owusu-Ansah, to help us digest this issue. Welcome, Doc.
Thank you.
How has your week been?
It was great.
Okay, and we are blessed to
hope
see
yours
today.
Was good too.
Yes, it was good. Thank you. So in our previous episode, just last episode, we talked about infertility in women. And just in passing, you made mention of the assisted conception technique.
Yes.
Yeah, so that's what we'll be treating today. We want to really treat it in detail for our guests to get one or two things from it. So my first question will be, this assisted technique, what is it about, and how did it just come about?
Okay.
Yeah.
So assisted conception technique is a broad term for a number of interventions,
okay,
which are aimed at helping the couple to achieve. Specifically, it's aimed at assisting the gametes, one of the gametes or the two. Gametes, I mean sperm and egg,
okay,
to achieve pregnancy.
Okay.
So it's a pretty broad topic, but it has several sub-interventions or procedures under it.
Okay, yeah. So you mentioned the something like collect different procedures, and also I want to act at this point. So when does it, in terms of infertility, at what point does this become the last option or the only option for a couple?
Okay, so the couple would have had a previous evaluation for infertility.
Yeah.
So once, and the evaluation is aimed at trying to find out the cause. We will preferably define infertility as failure to achieve a pregnancy after 12 months of regular and protected intercourse.
Okay.
So after that, you seek a doctor's evaluation. And in his evaluation, he's trying to find out, is it a problem with the man, is it a problem with the woman, or both?
Okay.
Uh-huh. Now, some parameters or some factors for fertility, let's say age, increasing maternal age, it's a factor. So it's a not so favorable factor for achieving pregnancy, naturally, spontaneously. If you have a very low sperm count, not so a favorable factor. If you do have, maybe you don't have, let's say, a womb, because of maybe previous traumatic or previous complications at childbirth, hysterectomy and all that, you will need one of those assisted techniques. So usually the candidates for assisted techniques are unexplained infertility for more than 2 years.
Okay.
Advanced maternal age, advanced 38, 40 and beyond.
Wow.
People who had their womb or uterus removed because maybe previous postpartum hemorrhage or some other medical problems, yes. So that means that that becomes the only option available to you, or very low sperm count, or no sperm at all.
At all. Oh, okay, yes. Okay.
So those are the four main. They will outrightly need.
Yeah, the assisted conception technique. Okay. So you mentioned that it's like various. I want to know the different or various approaches to this assisted conception technique. What are the various approaches?
So broadly, we have the IVF, as in vitro fertilization, and embryo transfer, so IVF ET.
Okay.
There's a sub procedure, and I'll call it ICSI, intracytoplasmic sperm injection, what is reserved for those who have very, very low sperm count. In that case, usually they tend to pick up the good sperm and inject direct into the egg. Then we have the surrogacy. That's either the traditional surrogate, which is not favorably done, but then, and the more like what we do often is the gestational surrogate, where the surrogate is not related to the baby she's carrying.
Okay.
So that's the more commonly done one. So those are the main broad ones. But still an evolving field anyway. Other procedures are being added on, but the three main broad ones.
Oh, okay. So can you walk us through a procedure? For instance, a lady comes to your office and opts for one of the techniques, or opts for an assisted conception technique. Can you just walk us through maybe the procedures from the interrogation to the process itself?
So usually a lady will walk in with a desire to wanting to conceive.
Sure.
And we prefer the first evaluation than with the male partner.
Okay.
So we come in person with the male partner, we evaluate. In that evaluation, we are seeking to trying to find out what the cause of infertility may be. But if we get to the point where we realize that, okay, one of these things I mentioned earlier is the reason, maybe she's like 42, wants a child. Because of declining ovarian reserve at 42, increased risk 42. Of abnormalities, chromosome anomalies of the pregnancy, if she uses her own egg, or even increased risk of miscarriage,
sure,
it would be a better option to use an IVF approach or assisted conception approach, using, let's say, a donor egg with consent.
And donor egg?
Egg.
Okay, what's consent. That about?
So what that means is that we will take an egg for a younger woman. The peak of fertility in women is between 20 and 24.
Sure.
So we take egg for a younger woman, maybe 18, 25, and then screen her medically, counsel her psychologically, and then stimulate her and take her eggs with consent, and then use her partner's sperm to fertilize it.
Wow.
And then transfer into her womb. That's in the man and the woman, the hair womb. So she gets pregnant, carries the baby to term, and delivers the baby.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. Okay, wow, I like, I think, okay, that was cool. I remember then, I don't know, okay, when I was in SHS then, and we usually laugh at some people and tell them they are test tube babies. Yeah. how is that done?
Oh, that's the informal term of test tube baby.
Okay.
Usually because of the way it came about, I think the first IVF baby was born in 1978 in July.
Wow.
In London, where that was what the term testing became. There have been several other, probably about 4 million babies born after that by the same technique, yes.
Yeah.
So there's this perception that probably the babies may not be all okay. That's why people can make fun or tease people with that
thing.
But then that's not entirely
true. It's just a perception. Mm-hmm. Okay. So are there times that this assisted conception technique, I won't say can go wrong, isn't or won't be successful? And if there are, what would be the reasons or the factors?
Well, yes, it's not 100% successful. Okay. It's probably depending on what approach you are using, what technique you involve. We are looking at probably from 35 to probably sometimes at most 70% success rate. Yeah.
Okay.
And then it depends on factors making it fail depend on one, the quality of the embryo.
Okay.
How well prepared the woman's womb was before the embryos were transferred. Even the transfer technique. So maybe the technical people involved.
Yeah.
Or even the cultures and all that. There are several, but you can't always find out why it failed. Some you can tell, some you can't.
You can't tell. Oh, okay. So
and sometimes even the very transition of leaving the lab into the woman's womb, some embryos may not survive.
Wow. But I think it's one, the movement, and two, there are two different conditions.
So it's very difficult to put a finger in all cases on why someone failed.
Okay, so you mentioned surrogacy as one of the interventions for the ACT Act, assisted conception technique. Can you walk us through that or just give a brief explanation of that?
Okay, so the surrogacy, as I mentioned earlier, there are two kinds, the traditional and the gestational. What we tend to do in the IVF is gestational, where the woman sort of hide in a way to carry the baby for a couple. Now, what happens is that usually you have a woman who either due to medical conditions, either maternal medical conditions or maybe problems with her womb, either being absent or some other problem, has been declared not capable or not conducive to carry a pregnancy on her own. So she would need someone else to do that for her. So usually, in some people, their eggs are viable, so you take their eggs, partner's sperm, and they add it, form the embryo, and put it in another person's womb.
Just to carry the baby.
Just to carry.
Okay. Uh-huh. Okay.
Some cases, it's not even her egg, it's another person's egg. But usually gestational surrogates are not related genetically to the baby they are carrying. In order to minimize
that
conflicts and emotional attachments.
Okay, so is it a rule, or is it like, should I say a rule that compulsory that a surrogate mother must be somebody unknown? Can I or can someone decide to volunteer to be a surrogate for maybe a friend or a relation? Is it allowed?
Oh yes, it's allowed. It can be done. We on this side all tend to try and discourage that because we don't want a scenario where somebody might come back want to lay claim to the child. But that said and done, every person who does this, either surrogate or donor, undergoes adequate counseling to understand what you are getting into and their responsibilities, their risks, as well as what their rights are and what they cannot have in terms of their limitations or prohibitions. Yeah. So, yes, you can do that.
Mm.
And then, because some in other jurisdictions, some people, some mothers carry for their daughters.
Yeah, I think I've seen something like that.
It can be done. But whoever is done is counseled and usually there are documents signed to this
agreement, that's what
so
I'm
it, it covers
to avoid any future. Okay, so let's talk about some risk that might be associated with this technique. I would want to think that maybe because it's not normal or it's not natural, let's say natural, it's not natural, there may be some risk, maybe birth defects or maternal defects, are there any risks associated different from the normal pregnancy?
Well,
risk?
The risks are mildly or slightly higher than the natural.
Okay.
But it's not any outstanding risk.
Okay.
The reason is that it's usually your own egg, your own sperm, that forms a new embryo. It's actually your baby. The only thing that is unnatural is the initial environment you grow up in for the first few days before they get transferred. That's the only thing that's unnatural.
Okay.
But aside that, everything else is. So there's a small risk of usually miscarriage, usually highest within the first 12 weeks, 13 weeks, thereabouts. And then usually after that time, the rest of the pregnancy proceeds normally as every other pregnancy. The other bit is another place where they do multiple embryo transfer, where more than one embryos or babies are placed in there. You do have, if all takes, you do have multiple pregnancy to deal with, where there's potential complication for mother and baby, increased risk of preterm labor, increased risk of preterm delivery, growth restriction, or prematurity for the babies as well. Yeah, maternal anemia, all the complications that come with multiple pregnancy can come if that was what
was done. Right. Oh, okay. Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay.
But then on the whole, it's a marginal something.
Oh, okay. If you just joined us, this is still Ladies Digest, and you can catch us up on our social media handles on Facebook and YouTube at the Association of African Universities, and our Instagram handle at Ladies Digest. We'll be back. Welcome back from the quick break, and we are discussing the assisted conception technique with Dr. Kweju Owusu-Ansah. Welcome back, Doc.
Thank you.
Yeah, so before the break, you mentioned, you talked about the multiple pregnancies, conceptions, and births. And funny enough, that was supposed to be my next question. This is my personal view. From observations or hearsay, it seems this assisted and conception technique, or let's just say the IVF, produces multiple births. I don't know if it's my own thought, if it's a myth or a fact, so I want clarification on that. Because most times when, especially ladies who are above 40 or so, and they give birth, it's usually more than one. There are usually three, there are two, three thereabouts. But you made mention of the fact that if they make it multiple. So I want to know if it's intentional or the act alone just makes it, produces multiple.
Well, it depends. It depends on what intervention they are using. If you are using just simple, the drugs that I use, some medications, some injections, will develop more than one follicle or quote-unquote an egg at the same time. Naturally, the ovary will select one at a time. That's a natural.
Okay.
Once you use those medications, so there's some risk, probably up to 8-10% risk of having a multiple, more than one egg being released, so multiple fertilizations and then multiple pregnancy. Yeah. Now, if you're doing the full-blown IVF where everything is done, fertilized in the lab and transferred in the womb, generally in our jurisdiction, the gradual shift now is to do what we call a single embryo transfer.
Okay.
So you take one embryo, even have a number of them ready to go. You take one good one, analyze, make sure genetic makeup, everything is fine, then transfer that single one. Because the multiple pregnancies are usually seen as a complication of the procedure. In our part of the world, but that is where you have a very sophisticated IVF setup.
Okay.
Where you can tell that one embryo you're placing is 100% genetically correct and everything looks good. Even though it can still fail.
Okay.
In our part of the world, a lot of factors, we do not do single embryo transfer as yet in most centers. And that's partly due to multiple factors. First of all, multiple pregnancy in its natural incidences, is more common on our side than the West.
Okay, I think.
So in terms of competencies or getting you, we are quite familiar and conversant with it. That aside, culturally, there's love for babies.
Okay.
More than one, more than two, three. It is not something that raise eyebrows
sure.
on our side.
Sure, uh-huh. sure. Okay.
So that is the, and then thirdly, given the financial implications of the procedure, most people, couple of you can't realize that, oh, they want more, because most of them would have been waiting for years.
Yeah.
There's cultural, societal pressure on them.
Exactly.
And then given the financial thing involved, they think, why? Why can't I get all at a go?
Go, then, so you don't, you know, come have. Back. Yeah.
So the couples also tend to want lean towards that. Yes. So that is made us. So where you have more than one embryo being placed, which is happening a lot in our side, if it's available, more than one will be placed, maybe two, at most four.
Okay.
You're likely to get a chance of a multiple pregnancy, and it's
birth.
Associated complications, yeah.
And it's because definitely there will be the associated complications. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Because I think it's because, for let's say, for a 45-year-old lady who has opted for that, instead of coming back for the same procedure, you just do it once and get at least two or three, and you are done. That's true. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about the acceptance, the perception, drawing. Far back from where it's coming from, you said 1979. Okay.
Yeah. So it's almost 42 years old.
Imagine. Okay. Yeah. So that the baby is 42.
42 years,
old.
To the first successful one.
Okay.
But there's a history behind it before 78.
I see.
Far back as 50s and 60s,
what?
People were trying.
Trying.
So it took
okay.
over 100 attempts before the first successful baby,
which was
40, was made in 1978.
Wow, 42.
So 42 years since the first successful baby.
Okay, how has the how would you say personally has the perception changed and the acceptance, and want to just narrow it down to Africa and even Ghana, because we don't know how it is in other countries. Let's say Ghana. How do you see the acceptance and the perception change?
Well, what I've seen from my experience is that. Yes, most couples come in not too sure or not too aware of such procedures.
Sure.
Okay. They come in with a simple request, we want to conceive after X number of years of trying. Uh-huh. But then along the way, depending on what parameters or their situation is, you realize that this might be the best pathway for them. So you start the counseling along those lines. Yes, most will go along with you because they want the child.
Yeah.
Usually the biggest barrier is the financial bit.
Exactly.
Uh-huh. But after they cross that part, yes. In terms of acceptance, they've been wanting children for long, so they are more open to the idea of acceptance. Yeah. What I've noticed is that culturally they tend not to disclose or say much about the fact that they did this procedure to have their babies.
Oh, okay. As in open up.
As I open up about the details to the society and maybe that's what I've realized. And I think that's because culturally we still have a lot of, I don't say misconceptions, but a lot of perceptions in society where even a simple, something simple as a mode of delivery, whether it was C-section or vagina, it's seen as, oh, you're not woman enough.
Enough, you if you don't push.
Exactly. Huh?
Yeah.
So I can see why they tend not to be very open with their friends or my relatives about the exact details. That's what I've realized. And that's probably people may not react to it. So I've seen a lot of people who, do the procedure. They are silent to the procedure, but they will show you their product. Oh, I got that delivered.
Yeah.
And that's it. Uh-huh. And it sort of goes to tell you that, oh, you thought I couldn't make it,
I've made it. Uh-huh. That is,
and they leave it at that.
But how I made it.
Exactly. Yeah, they are silent on that side.
Oh, okay. Well, but I don't think it should be, because they are still babies. They are still human beings.
Well, yes, but it's I know. I understand where they're coming from.
It's
our culture is very,
yes,
quite sometimes tough to navigate.
It's true, yeah, the culture. Mm-hmm. We are still a bit back with that in mm-hmm. that aspect. Okay, so let's talk about some challenges. I don't know if there will be some challenges that new practitioners face with this technique. So yeah, we are talking about from the patients to any other reason that any other challenge you face in this procedure from the beginning till it's successful.
Okay, usually the challenges will be from the patient itself, the evaluation and the workup. Usually we'll have somebody who's probably been around other places, had one or two other interventions done, may have one or two complications in the process, may have had previous surgeries for other gynecological like fibroids or endometriosis, other procedures done. You know, some do come who are quite advanced maternal, maybe 40 and you may have coexisting medical problems, let's say diabetes, hypertension, thyroid disease, which are not so well controlled, or they don't even know they had that.
Had it, yeah.
Which might have been a contributing factor to infertility.
So that has to be
treated. So, sure, those are the initial challenges. Then you have to optimize the woman, and then sometimes you do a semen analysis and it's not good enough. You have to optimize the man too as well.
Okay.
So those are the initial challenges. So it's getting them ready.
Okay.
So once they are ready and the procedure goes on, usually the rest should go on successfully. Occasionally you will get complications from side effect or the medications, the injections, you know, because of the hyperstimulation syndrome where they'll get bloated, they'll get a bit of a fluid retention and all that from the side effects of the, of the injections we use.
And I don't know how true, just one clarification, that diabetes is very common. I don't know if it's related to the bloatedness. Is diabetes really very, very common with this process for the ladies? I know it's quite common with every pregnant.
Yes, what happens is that if she does get pregnant, you are likely to have a woman who is advanced in age, who is now pregnant, probably for the first time. So a first-time mother, advanced maternal age, had an IVF procedure, automatically that's a high-risk pregnancy.
Yeah.
Even before any other thing
any
comes
other
in.
Thing,
exactly.
That's true.
So that also, because of the age, you might find a woman who's probably either it's maybe a very early onset of diabetes or some early onset of some other medical problem. That problem was there, but probably might be accelerated by being pregnant.
So, you know. That should be okay. So let's talk about, we're almost wrapping up, let's talk about evaluation of the patient. So yeah, the lady has given birth successfully. Are there any special, should I say, special follow-up procedures or evaluations done for a lady who goes through this process, so it's just the normal postnatal doctor treatment?
Well, it depends on how the pregnancy plays out.
Okay.
If she usually will take it trimester by trimester.
Yeah.
Once you cross 13 weeks, there's a very small percentage of having a miscarriage or pregnancy likely to go on to the end. So we get to the end of it, maybe around 20 weeks, we do a scan to see that baby is normal.
Okay.
So all fetal or structural factor, structural organs are assessed. And then we are sure that, you know, we are sure that we can get it sorted out. So that's then said, we can also do, other maternal evaluations, let's say for blood sugar, every athlete has a blood pressure check and all that. If the pregnancy remains uneventful, no complication whatsoever for mother and baby, after delivery, it's usually regular postnatal follow-up. For the mother, you might do a bit of an extended maybe a couple of months after because of the age and the fact she got pregnant. I sometimes tend to see them for as long as maybe a year.
Wow.
Depending on possibly depending on what the issues that that was there before and after or during pregnancy as So it's a case by case thing. But then usually if it goes normal, if let's say she's a young group, let's say 30s or 20s, has IVF, goes through everything, baby's fine, mother's fine, no complication developed whatsoever. It follows regular follow-up schedule.
So this is just, it's quite a weird question, but is there a possibility that after a lady does the IVF for a first conception, is there a possibility that she can conceive naturally whatsoever?
Oh yes, it happens. Okay. It depends on what the parameters before the IVF was done were. Some can be modified or fixed. Let's say if her woman was fine, and the only issue was the male factor, where the sperm count was low.
Okay.
And then maybe treatment was very slow, or you know, you could do the IVF process. And then and I've had several like that after.
Oh, okay.
That you do the IVF and then spontaneous conception happens afterwards.
Wow, okay. So it's possible. Yeah. Just depending on the condition and the parameters.
But if it's an advanced one, let's say 45.
Five.
It's not likely spontaneous will happen.
Yeah, or if maybe there is no womb or anything.
Yeah.
There's no possibility. Mm-hmm. Okay. So this is our last question, and this is personal. We are wrapping up. And you furthered your training for, you obtained a fellowship in assisted reproductive techniques in India.
Yeah.
And you have since successfully helped several women achieve their dreams of becoming mothers through these various techniques. And the oldest being a 59-year-old woman. So my question will be, what informed this your decision to even venture into that aspect of medicine? And also, how has the experience been, especially that particular case?
Well, so experience medicine, gynecology or infertility?
Infertility, specializing in that.
I think it comes with residency training, postgraduate training, where you realize as you go through the different fields of obs and gyne, you realize that there are certain things that come easy, certain things that are difficult. I found infertility challenging, you know, and then I found myself maybe inadvertently or unexpectedly in a fertility center. Assisting some other senior colleagues, and then things changed such that I had to be sort of stepping.
Yeah.
You know, so I realized that all of a sudden I was flooded with a lot of cases, you know. So I think that exposure started slowly turning my interest in that way.
Oh, okay.
So I followed up in that pathway and I finally decided to go train on it.
Okay, yeah. And how has the experience been so far?
Well, it's very interesting. Very interesting. They are disappointing days, they are very exciting days, you know. But sometimes unpredictable, in spite of best efforts and intentions. The outcomes are unpredictable. And sometimes you are caught in the middle. The people would feel, oh, you let them down.
Mm.
But it's a science, and a science is not 100% perfect, unfortunately. So it's, you know, we have our moments, good days and bad
and
days.
Bad days, yeah.
Yeah. But with that particular case, that said and done, we do not encourage IVF beyond 50.
Oh, you so, do not encourage it?
No, as a general rule, don't encourage it because of chance that it might not even work.
Okay.
And then they might have coexisting medical problems that might make issues complicated.
Very complicated.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we tend not to do. But she was a different case.
Wow.
That I think, I don't know why, but then she went around. A lot of fellow colleagues decided not to
try
because of obvious rules and everything, you know. But the whole lot of talking to, I said, fine, let's see what. And so she would bear my, I did a whole regular screening at every turn to the end, yes. Because I didn't want any complication to come. Sure. She was hypertensive, by the way.
Wow.
But that was the only problem she had, you know. And yes, multiple attempts. It didn't come at the first time.
Oh, multiple attempts.
Yeah, wow. Two or three times.
Wow.
But it worked.
Wow.
So she's 60 now with the 1 year
job. This is lovely.
But sometimes that's what we don't tend to do, because if I project, I'm looking at, she'll be 17 and that
child will be 10 or so.
You know, so over like time you realize that, okay, it may not be the best idea to do. But other jurisdictions like Asia, India, they've done 60-something-year-old. Even I think Nigeria has had some advanced, pretty advanced, you know. People are trying to help each other with that.
But I see.
It's just not recommended.
It's not. It's quite risky. Yeah.
Exactly, because it's aside the risk, you're looking at the child.
Exactly.
You have a child to very advanced aged parents.
Yeah.
You know.
It's true. Losing. Well, maybe she has made some. She might have put some things in place.
Those are the issues. You know. So it's more like an moral, ethical,
50-50 but I think she will really be grateful. She'll be really grateful.
Yes, she'll be very grateful. But I'm not too sure I want to repeat that.
you wouldn't want to repeat it?
I don't know. It's still a debate.
but it's good. At least I know you feel good, like as in achieved that. You've
some
tried
sense
something.
Of accomplishment, yes. Uh-huh. Because of the you know that the persistent paid off, you know. Yeah. But I think that maybe we'll debate again if we'll do that.
Okay. Thank you for joining us on Ladies Digest. Yeah, and we hope to see you some other time. This has been Ladies Digest, and many thanks to my production team for making this production a very successful one. Till I come your way next time, I'm Joni Kuya. You are to stay tuned.
The Association of African Universities, AAU, is an international non-governmental organization set up by universities in Africa to promote cooperation among themselves and the international academic community.
Mon nom est Professeur Étienne Ehouan Eilé. Je suis le secrétaire général de l'Association des universités africaines qui est basée à Accra, au Ghana. Je vais vous parler de la création de l'Association des universités africaine. Il faut remonter dans les années 60 pour pouvoir comprendre le processus. Déjà en 1960, nos dirigeants estimaient que l'éducation est l'outil majeur pour pouvoir lutter contre la pauvreté et assurer le développement.
I am not Tumo Dlamini. I'm the Director of ICT Services and Knowledge Management at the Association of African Universities. The Association of African Universities is a network of 400 universities in Africa. The biggest value that the universities benefit from being members of the association is this big platform that allows them to collaborate, allows them to work together, allows them to teach together. Through this platform, a university in North Africa can work with a university in Southern Africa, and also those in East Africa can work with those in West Africa.
Founded November 1967 at a conference in Rabat, Morocco, by heads of African higher education institutions, the association is currently headquartered in Accra, Ghana.
My name is Maxwell Amohoit. I'm the Director of Finance of the Association of African Universities. The association sustains itself from contributions from member universities and also from other development partners. Some of our development partners include the World Bank, other governmental agencies like the Swedish International Development Agency, UK Department for International Development, and other partners. We also receive a lot of support from other governments, especially the government of Ghana. Other partners include the African Union, which is more or less the parent organization of the Association of African Universities. The Association of African Universities hosts the Secretariat for the African Union's Continental Education Strategy. And by so doing, we provide coordinating roles for the African Union in helping members achieve their targets.
Déjà en 1960, nos dirigeants estimaient que l'éducation est l'outil majeur pour pouvoir lutter contre la pauvreté et assurer le développement. Et rappelons-nous que les années 60, la décade 60, a été une décade où la plupart des pays africains ont obtenu leur indépendance ou ont, disons, pris les dispositions pour être indépendants. C'était donc aussi l'année de développement, dans la mesure où tous ces pays indépendants devaient se retrouver de temps en temps pour parler de comment mettre ensemble leurs problèmes et trouver une solution commune à leurs problèmes. Et dans ce contexte-là, l'éducation était une priorité pour eux. Surtout l'éducation universitaire. Et sur ce plan-là, les universités aussi se sont organisées grâce à l'UNESCO qui a parrainé plusieurs réunions depuis Madagascar jusqu'au Maroc.
My name is Jonathan Umba. I'm the Director of Research and Academic Planning. The programs and projects that we run at AAU are consistent with our strategic plan, and they are implemented for our higher education stakeholders, namely the higher education.